Yesterday we were working on Mr. Robot, and we are going to continue with that. It's still starting up. Okay, so it's up now, and we already have our reverse shell code in place. So let me first open up a listener. What was the port? Let me just log in and check what port did I specify. Okay, 5555. Okay. So I'll just open up the listener using netcat, and we just need to basically get the error page. We have our shell. So let us first upgrade this to a better shell using this Python command. Okay, so we are currently running as this daemon service, so we are not logged in as any user. So we don't have any password, any credentials for any account. We're just able to have shell access on the system. So what would you suggest is the first thing I try to do now?
Where am I? It's a demon room.
Pardon?
Who am I? then we can have
Who
the we can check for the root access.
am I? I mean, the same thing we have done with ID. So we are this daemon
Okay.
user. Okay,
Oh.
so we don't really have any credentials for this account. So even if I wanted to do something like sudo hyphen l, I would not be able to do that because I don't have any passwords here. And no passwords exist for these accounts because this is not a user account. This is just a service account on the system. So even if it had a password, this sudo hyphen l would not work. Or I mean, it would not really be helpful because it's not going to be having any permissions of those sort. Now, so what should I do now? Like, how do, should I proceed with this? Any ideas?
Metasploit doesn't work here.
Without Metasploit, there is a way to do this with Metasploit, but Metasploit, you know, if we do everything with Metasploit, then it's not really going to teach us anything. Once you get like admin access, there is a like admin access to the website, this WordPress website that I showed you here. There is a Metasploit plugin, the module, sorry, not plugin, which is known as WP Shell. WP admin shell upload. So that will help you get a shell with Metasploit. I've written the name of the module in chat.
We can check the users here.
We can like the number of users or how many users exist or their directories. What exactly do should we check?
Users.
Users. Okay, so if I want to check users, I can say so of course there's going to be the root account which is present on every system. There are service accounts for MySQL, okay, and something known as Varnish, and there is an account for robot. So this is definitely a user. Now the next thing I can do is I can try checking the directories, the home directories for these users and see what I find. So that is exactly what I'm going to do. First I'll go to home. Okay, see what directories are present. There's just this one user directory called robot and we have permissions to access it. So we'll access it. We'll see what files are present. Okay, so there are two files present here. One of these is the second flag for this machine and the other one is just password.rowmd5. Okay. So if I try to access the key file, just copy paste this because there's no tab. So permission denied. I don't have permissions to read that file. Only the robot user has that. And however, I can read the password file, see what I find here. Cat and this file. So this is the content of this file, robot, and what appears to be a hash. Now, since you know it's already been mentioned here that it's a raw MD5 hash, so we know what kind of hash this is. But in case you're not okay, in case we don't know what hash this is, we can just open up a new tab, and there's a tool called hash identifier. Just open it, and it'll tell you what type of hash function has been used for this. Now, you don't necessarily need this if you want to crack it with a tool like John the Ripper, so that's not required necessarily here, but it is always helpful if you know that. So MD5, but we already knew that since the file itself specifies that. Now what I'm going to do is I have this, I'll just copy this entire thing. So this is possibly the password for this robot account, and we can try cracking it now. So I'll open up a new window, and I'll create a new file, nano password. I'll paste this here, exit, save and exit, and I'll use John the Ripper to crack it. So I'll just start by trying with John and the name of the file, which is password. It's a raw MD5, so I can also specify the format. No password hashes left to crack. Let me check why it's doing this. Has it already cracked it? Okay, it has cracked it already. So this is the password. Actually, I think this is from the previous time when I cracked it the last time. So I need to delete the cache file for it. Okay. So once you crack a password with John, it's going to store that in its cache file. And the thing is, I'll need to specify a word list because brute forcing is not going to work in this case. So let me specify a word list. Let's try with fasttrack.txt first. Okay, not. Because if the password is in this file, then it's not going to take a lot of time. Session completed. Okay, has it found already? No, hasn't cracked it yet. So let me just change the word list and use rawq.txt. And again, it has, in this case, it has cracked it. So the password is, with John, you need to specify the show option to show the result of the password cracking. So the password is just the English alphabet and I'll just copy this so I don't have to type it. Now what we can do is switch user, robot, password we already have, and we are now logged in as this user on this system. Let's see if we have any sudo permissions here. Okay, so we don't have any sudo permissions, but you should be able to see the flag now. Just cat this file. Okay, and so this is our second flag for the system. Now there's only one left, and that is the final flag, or what is also known as the root flag. So in order to get that, we need to escalate our privileges to that of the root account. And the way we do that, let's see how we do that. So we don't have sudo permissions. Okay. There is no other files here. Root directory, of course, is not going to be accessible to us. So,
sir, how did you check that key too? Because we didn't have permission, right?
Yeah, but we are logged in as this robot account now.
Ah, okay.
That account has read permissions.
Okay.
Yeah. Robot account, the owner, that read permission. So we were able to read this flag. Now we just have one left. Okay, now when we talk about file permissions, there is an important concept in Linux known as set UID bit. Okay, are you familiar with this?
No, sir.
No? Let me go to the browser and okay. So this definition here tells us that it's a file permission setting, just like we have read, write, and execute. Now this is a special setting which allows a user to execute a particular file with the permission of the file owner. So what that means is, let's say there is an executable file here and it has this set UID bit set. So instead of an X for an executable file, you will see an S. Instead of X, it will be S for set UID. What that will mean is, if I'm running that program, if I'm executing that program, let's say I'm executing that program as robot, but the owner of that executable file is root. So when I execute that program, I will have the privileges of root. For me, a non-root account, when that program runs, it will execute with the privileges of the root account. So that means if I am able to use that program to get me a shell or to open a file, then I can do that as root. So, okay, this will become a little clearer when we see it in practice. So the way to proceed with that is, okay, now this is when it comes to privilege escalation, this is one of the first things you look for. Okay, after you check whether you have sudo permissions or not, one of the first things you see is whether you have any set UID files or not. If you have, then you try to see whether you can use them for your privilege escalation purposes. Okay, so let's start with that. Now, to find all such files on a system, There is, of course, the command, the find command itself. So this command find, that is what we are going to use. Now with this command, the first thing we need to specify is where to start looking for, like what directory to consider when looking for the file. Now I wanted to look in the entire system because I don't know where I might find something. So I'll just specify this, the main directory. So it will start looking from there, and whatever subdirectories are present, it will look in all of them. Now I need to specify some criteria, like what kind of files do I need to get. Now with the set UID thing, I know that I'm looking for a particular permission type. So I specify this hyphen PERM option. Now what kind of permissions? For the set UID bit, you have hyphen U is equal to S. So that means there is a set UID bit set for this, for the user permissions. And what type? Are we looking for a directory or are we looking for a file? So type is F for a file. But if I do this, you'll notice something, that as we run through this thing, we are going to get a lot of permission denied errors. Okay, like see here, permission denied, permission denied. Usually we get a lot more of these, and these really cloud the output. You know, these really make it difficult to read the output. So there is a way to get past this as well. See, a permission denied has, you know, clouding all our results. Okay, that's a lot of errors. So these are all different errors. What I can do is I can tell the find command, or any command for that reason. What was the command? This. Now, what I'm doing here with this redirection command, with to redirect to dev null. What I'm doing is I'm redirecting all the errors in a way that they are going to be discarded. This two represents the error descriptor. Okay, it's a file descriptor which denotes errors. And what we want to do is we don't want to see errors in our output. Okay, when I'm running this command, I don't want to see all these errors on my screen, because this is okay, a lot of them. Okay, there are a lot of errors. So what I want to do is I want to redirect all these errors to this null device, which is in this dev folder. Now this is where usually all your drives are mounted. There is also this null device or null file, which is a system file. Anything that you output to this file is discarded completely. So you want to ignore that output, you send it to dev null, that will be completely discarded. You won't see it anywhere. So if I run this command now, you'll see that none of the errors are going to show up. Okay, so the command has finished running, and the errors, none of the errors are showing up in this case. So this makes our output much more easy to read, okay, much cleaner. And now we can have a much better look at this output. So let's see how we are going to do that. Okay, so our purpose was to find files which have the set UID bit. And for all such files, Okay, the permissions. Let me just show you the permissions for any one of these. So let's say this first result we consider. Now this ping program has the SUID bit set. That means instead of an X, we find an S. So RWS instead of RWX. And the owner is root. That means regardless of who runs this program, regardless of who is executing this, when it is running, it is running with root privileges. So even if I execute it, the program will run with root privileges. Even though I am not the root user, I don't have root privileges.
Sir, if you set user ID as yes instead of X, yes, that means whoever runs that particular application file opens or anything. So that is considered like that is open through root, you meant to say?
It is the privileges of the root account. Like, let's say for Windows, when you're running this, some programs ask us for administrator permissions, right?
Yes,
that you need to run this as an administrator. So what happens is, even if you are not the admin account, if you run as administrator and you have the admin password, then your account is going to run that file with the privileges of an administrator account, with the permissions of an administrator account. So this is similar to what is happening here. When this program is run by whatever user on this system, when this is executed, it runs with root privileges. What that means is, let's say we are talking about a program. Okay, let's say I'm talking about the cat command. Okay, just for example, let's suppose. Now the cat command is used to, mainly we use it to open files and stuff. Now if that program has this kind of situation, then what is going to happen is the cat command can open any file, even so let's say that we are currently looking for root.txt, but I don't have root permissions. However, if I use cat to open root.txt, it will be able to do so if it has the SUID bit, because cat is running with root privileges. So it can do whatever root can do. So it can open any file that root can open. It can perform any function with root privileges. I think when I actually show you the privilege escalation part for this, that will make it a little clearer. Now these all files, ping, umount, mount, ping 6, password. Now these are all just system files. And they are not going to help us with privilege escalation in this case. So these always have the SetUID bit set. So they're not going to be of much use to us. And same goes for the other files. But take a look at this. Okay, we have nmap. Let's check the permissions. Because remember, this kind of thing is only useful to us if root is the owner of that file. Otherwise, whoever is the owner will be running that file as that particular user because it has the SetUID bit. Okay, so this nmap binary has root as the owner, and of course it has the SetUID bit. That's why it showed up in these results. Okay, so if we are somehow able to use nmap to get a shell or open a file for us, then it will be doing that with root privileges. But so far, whenever we have used nmap, we have seen nothing of this sort. Like nmap is not used to open files, nmap is not used to get a shell. With nmap we just run scans. right? That is what we've seen so far. So whether this will actually be useful for us or not, we'll have to figure out. Now with mmap, I can check the version for nmap. So nmap version is 3.81. okay, so this is, remember, this is on the Mr. Robot system. Now if I check the version on my device, the current version is 7.80. okay, so this is a very old version, 3.81. the current version of nmap is 7.8. this actually, I think it's 7.9. I have to update. So anyway, this is a very old version. So when you find something like this, old versions of software, they are more likely to be having some kind of vulnerabilities, or they are more susceptible to things like privilege escalation. So let's see. What I can do is, I want to do privilege escalation. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to note down this number 3.81. I go to Google and map 3.81, and I'm going to say privilege escalation. Now you can see, you'll find quite a few articles. So we can click on any of these. If you are able to find what we're looking for, then. Okay, this does not really, he does not really explain how to do this. He's just talking about it. Let's try this one. Okay. So, okay, he says this version of nmap has an interactive mode in which we are able to execute commands on the system, and it can be called with nmap interactive. Okay, let's try that. Nmap interactive. Oh, look at that. We have this interactive version of nmap now. What does it say next? Okay, so we can run all the system commands here. So if I press who am I? Okay, I'll need this. So who am I? So okay, I'm root. Because nmap has the set uid bit running, so it is going to run as root. It is going to run with the privileges of root, no matter who has actually triggered that executable. Okay, now I can use this to my advantage. Let's see if I can get a bash shell. Okay, I'm getting a bash shell. Good. ID, okay, no, bash shell is not going to work here. Exit out of it. Oh, I think I exited out of the system by mistake. No worries, I can always SSH back to it. Oh, yeah, I forgot SSH was not running, I think. Okay, no problem. I will just go here again. Must be done, run from a terminal. I need to do this. The password would be somewhere here, or was it here? Oh, I misspelled it. So I can use this sh. Okay, now I have a shell. Let me check. ID is user ID is robot, but effective user ID or EUID is root. So who am I? Root. Now, can I try to move into the root directory? Yes, I can. Also, I can get myself a better shell now. ID is not going to fly. Okay, still we are able to get to the root directory ls, and if you ls you will see there's this key 3 of 3.txt. So let's try accessing it. And there we go. So now we have the third and final flag on this system. So this CTF is done, we have solved it. Do you have any questions regarding this particular CTF, regarding the process that we followed?
These steps are a bit complicated. I couldn't grasp what all things you have done. So.
Like from the very beginning or?
Just no, from the interactive. From the interactive.
From the interactive. Okay.
Yeah.
So, from the interactive, I just did. I just basically followed what I saw here. Nothing else. From interactive, I just did who am I. So I got root. After that, now I know that within nmap, okay, nmap is running. This is an interactive version of nmap that we used. We checked, okay, so it told us that we are root, and we use this sh. Okay, so exclamation mark is needed before you run anything within this sort of system, within the interactive nmap. So if you want to run a system command, you need to use exclamation mark and sh to get a shell, very basic shell. Within that shell, it tells us that we have the effective user ID is root. Now, once we have that, we can try to access any files, any directories, and perform any functions that root can do.
It didn't ask any password. So directly it will go to that interactive. When you use that, SUID.
See what is happening is, like, we figured out that nmap has the set UID bit set. So we saw that here.
Yes,
We
sir.
found out what version is being used. Okay, so version is 3.81. So we
Yes, sir.
just googled that. Okay, now you may, of course, you will come across a lot of situations where the softwares you come across, you'll not be familiar with them or you'll not have used them. Like this is a very old version. Okay, we haven't used it. So we can just Google this kind of stuff when we come across it. Now, it tells us that Nmap, for Nmap, there is an interactive version.
Sir, how did you find that privilege escalation is used for this Nmap and all? Like, what exactly privilege escalation contains here? Means like privilege access we'll be having like that, anything?
See, privilege escalation is a concept. Okay. When we had shell access on the system, okay, we were logged in as a user service. Sorry, as a system service, not a user service. There's no such thing as user service. So what we needed to do was we needed to escalate or we needed to elevate or raise our privileges to that of a proper account on the system. So we first did that. Okay, we had that password file, we cracked it, and we logged in as the robot user. But now we needed to get root privileges. Okay, a normal user account does not have root privileges or admin privileges if you're talking about Windows. So privilege escalation means you're escalating or you're elevating your privileges so that you have more control over the system and you can perform more functions there. Because no other account has as much control over the system as the root account or the admin account. So whenever you are like hacking on this system, when you are hacking a system, your first task or your, sorry, not first task, your ultimate goal is to be able to get root access there. Okay, you may get user access, but still you will keep trying to get root access because that's what matters most. And any system, if you're able to run as root, if you're able to run as admin, that means you can do anything on that system. Now, when we logged in as Mr. Robot, the next thing we needed to do is get to root, escalate our privileges to root. Now, there are lots of different ways in which you can perform this function, this privilege escalation. The first is to check for our privileges, our pseudo privileges. Maybe that will allow us to run an executable and elevate our privileges. That is one way. We checked for that first, so that didn't happen. The next thing we check is this set UID, because this is also a common way to perform privilege escalation on a system. Now we did find an executable which we were able to make use of for this thing. Now, okay, we didn't exactly know beforehand how to perform this privilege escalation using Nmap. So that's the part that we Googled. And it's basically, you see, it's telling you all that you need to do. No. How to perform this privilege escalation using Nmap. Okay, this is the part that we've done already. The find part. After that, Nmap, run it in interactive mode. Try running who am I and you'll find out that you are running as root. When you are running as root, if you try to get a shell access, if you open a shell, then that shell will also be running as root. Like you'll be running as a root account on that shell, or your effective privileges will be that of the root account in this case, because Nmap has that set UID bit in its permissions. So when I open a root, when I open a shell with Nmap, that shell has root privileges, and using that I needed to find the flag. I needed to open this key file, and that is what I did. So whatever command I need to run on this system as root, after I get root using this interactive nmap shell, I can do that.
So after that, what you'll do? Like, we got the root username password and we have access to shell also.
So see, in a CTF, the goal is to find the root flag. Okay. And the root flag is something that you'll find at the end. You'll first find user flags, and you know, usually there's just two flags, user flag and root. In this case, we had three. So after we became root, we had to get the value of the root flag, and that's it. There's nothing else to do with regards to the CTF. If you are on an actual system, then it depends what you want to do. You want to get some data, you want to steal data, you want to upload something there, you want to download something from there, you want to, you know, just mess with whatever it is running. Whatever you want to do, that's up to you. You want to edit some files, you can do whatever you want since you have root access.
And here we are not using any nmap feature. I thought like when we have access to nmap, so we can use nmap features and all.
Yeah, that's right. We are not using any nmap features. Making use of one very old functionality of nmap to get root access. And you see this further ahead as well, that if you are using a program, of if you're using a file, if you're using an executable, just like we've done with nmap, if you're using that for privilege escalation, it's not necessary that you'll be using the features of that particular program itself. You might be making use of just a particular aspect of it. Now, we are not really running a scan with nmap here. So like you said, we are not using nmap's core functionality. But whatever works, we have to use it. When it comes to penetration testing, when it comes to solving CTFs like this, whatever you get, you have to use it. Okay. Whatever you find, even if you find something that you have never come across before, but you know, okay, this is going to work, just use it. Now, in this case, we had to Google how to do that. And there will be a lot of situations where we'll have to do it. But if it works, it works. If I want to get root, I have to use nmap, or I had to use any other executable to do it, I would have done that. With penetration testing, you don't really have lots of different options. If you find something, you just stick with it. Anything else?
Sir, my bigger question is like, we are doing with the virtual machine, but how to find actual machine? But many times we may not find, right? So in that case, like I want to check for particular machine, which we already have access to that machine. So like we need to find out from the network, like we have to start, we are doing penetration testing in our company, if you consider. So I have to start from the network. So I should, from my laptop, I should first discover that machine, right? So in that case, if like, how to find that? Like if I do that nmap, automatically it will do. Because here all the machine in one virtual machine, so and we did some setup and all, because of that we are accessing. So if anything is like they have, if there is a loophole, then only we can get that particular machine, how it is.
See, when
it is not configured.
When you're doing a penetration test, you're not going to be focusing on one particular machine. Your focus will be to just, your focus will be to find out how you can get into the system or how you can hack your organization's assets, how someone can do that. That's not necessarily to focus just on one system. Okay, so if you're able to perform network scans with Nmap, you're able to find vulnerabilities, or you're able to find something within a website that gives you access. So you just stick to that and you see what you can do with it. You are not going to be confined to a particular system that, okay, no, you have to target this particular system. Even in a attack, when attackers are performing any cyber crimes, they don't target particular systems. They say, okay, well, if I can get access to this organization's data, if I can access their database, I'm not going to just focus on a particular machine. I'll use whatever machine I am able to, and I'll just go ahead with my work. So in a penetration test, of course, you have some limitations, but you also have a lot of freedom. Okay, in a sense, you are restricted. You have certain rules to follow. There are some, you have a well-defined scope that you have to stick to. There'll be some attacks that you will not be allowed to use. Most probably stuff like denial of service. But you also have a lot of freedom. Now in a CTF, we only have one machine as a target. So we just focus on that. But that's not going to be the case with a realistic pen test. And the reason we use CTFs is because with a CTF, they're actually saying, okay, you can use this, hack it. Otherwise, what you would have to do is you'd have to configure a lot of systems on your own network, or within, even if you do that within your virtual environment, virtual machine environment, you would have to do a lot of configuration yourself just to be able to practice. That's why we use different kinds of CTFs to get a lot of practice, get an idea of the kind of situations you will find yourself in when you perform penetration tests.
Sir, you told there are many other ways to do this. So if you tell, then we can try those things.
Other ways to do what?
Exactly? Whatever we have done, accessing a root, hacking that CTS thing.
Privilege escalation. Are you saying that there's different ways to do privilege escalation? Okay. Because there are different ways, of course, but every way is not going to work on every machine. So for this device, this way worked. Okay, there was an old version of Nmap and it had the SATUID bit set. So we were able to exploit that and escalate our privileges. But this was not the case with the previous machine that we were targeting. We could not have used the exact same thing there because it was configured in a different way. So again, the route that you take or the process that you follow to perform privilege escalation will be different for different systems. But these are some very basic ways which we try for at the very beginning, looking for our sudo permissions, trying to find SETUID files. These are some very basic ways which we always try to look for.
Okay.
Because it's relatively easier to do this rather than have to perform some very complex stuff just to gain our, just to escalate privileges. And there are actually scripts. Okay. When you run those scripts on your system, it will tell you how many different ways you can use or how many how the system is configured in such a way that you will be able to escalate your privileges on it. And I'll be doing that in a future CTF as well. But if you want that script, I'll just give you the link. I'll be using that script in another device, but I'll give you the link for it. In chat, I'll be doing that. So, okay, I've pasted this link. And basically, it does is it's a simple, okay, I won't say simple because it has a lot of stuff in it, but it's a bash script. So you can run it in Linux on whatever system you are targeting. You have to run it on that system itself, and it'll tell you whether there's something you can use on that system to escalate your privileges. So there are others as well, but this is, I think, one of the best that I've used. Actually, this is the best that I've used, so that's why I'm giving you this link. So when you run this script, okay, let's okay, I have the script on my system. Let me show you how this works. Did someone write something in chat? No. Okay. Now I'm going to come out of the system. There's nothing else to do. Now I have this script right here, linpeace. All I have to do is execute it. And when it runs, okay, it should run. Okay, so when it runs, basically what it tries to do is it tries to check for different ways in which you could perform privilege escalation on this system. Okay, so I'm running it on my Linux system, so it's going to check for how I can perform privilege escalation on my system. And it has this different color coding. So if you see something that's highlighted like this, then that's very helpful for privilege escalation. If something is red, then you must take a look at it. Others are not going to be helpful. So it takes a long while to run. So I'm just going to cancel it for now. So there, you can also use a script like this to help you with privilege escalation.
Even vulnerability scanner also tells almost same thing, right? Here, okay, privilege escalation is giving, but
privilege escalation is just for, like, if you have root, if you are running an account on a system, but you want to get root access now, that would be an example of privilege escalation.
Okay.
A vulnerability scanner is going to look for any vulnerabilities on that system. It does not necessarily have to do anything with privilege escalation. Any vulnerabilities that might help you hack onto the system or, you know, do some kind of damage to that system would be picked up by a vulnerability scanner. So these are two very different things, vulnerability scanning and privilege escalation. And the entire purpose of running these different scripts and tools is also different. So again, see, there's a lot of stuff when it comes to penetration testing. It's a vast amount of, you know, there's a vast amount of knowledge to be had when it comes to this. So we don't really, previous class, just give me a minute. So gradually you build upon things, gradually you build up your skills. You're not going to learn everything at once, because see, with penetration testing, all what you're trying to do is you're trying to hack into a system, and there's millions of different configurations that are possible in the world. Okay, there's lots of different devices, all of whom are configured in their own way. So of course the ways to hack them will also be like they'll vary a lot. Penetration testing also, okay, you will come across, there will be a lot of situations where you'll come across something that you haven't seen before or that you haven't worked with before. And you will have to, you know, rely on Googling stuff. And that happens, that is natural, okay. That is something that's going to happen.
Sir, yeah. We'll do few this one penetration test is little bit slower, sir.
Little
like
slower.
I'm getting confused with all those things. So yeah, one or two if I do with you, then at least I feel like a little bit confident on these things.
Okay. Sorry for that. Yeah. I'll keep it in mind. I'll try to be. Okay, even during the class, if you feel I'm going fast, no, just feel free to like stop me there and tell me that, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Actually, if I'm trying to execute some kind of command, then I'll miss few explanations. It is happening like that, so.
Okay. So feel free to, you know, just stop me during the, whenever I'm moving fast.
Yes, sir.
So can I'll try to keep in mind, I'll go a little slower.
Okay, sir.
Now, for the next thing that we're going to do, we'll not be doing something like what we've done so far. Okay, we'll not be doing the same thing. We'll work a little differently now. And we are going to be working on some web-based challenges. So not exactly the traditional CTFs that we've been doing so far. I mean, I'll come back to those as well, but just for a change of pace, we'll work on some web-based challenges. Okay, we'll start by working on some war games. There is this website, overthewire.org. Okay, so they have this thing called war games. So these are challenges basically online, completely online. So you don't have to like download or install anything in this case. All you need to do is you need to have an internet connection and you need to connect to these different challenges using SSH. So it can help you practice some security concepts in the form of, they say it's fun-filled games. It's basically like, it's like CTF challenges, but not in the way that we've seen before. Okay, so starting from the next session, for a few sessions, we'll be working on this. And we start with this one, Bandit. So this is the first one. And I'll start from this tomorrow.